Hey guys, it's Danny. Today we're gonna have a fun video, at least I hope so. We're gonna talk about the orchids that I find simply overrated. There are those orchids that people keep talking about, but some of these I actually did have and some I didn't, but by looking at pictures or videos, I don't think I'm very impressed. So today I'm gonna list for you the orchids that I simply find overrated. Now mind you, some of these orchids you might be a total fan of. So if you are, leave a comment down below telling us why you love this orchid, so that people who never owned these orchids have a better picture of things. So everything is personal here, of course, this is my opinion. Totally fine if you absolutely love these orchids. And if you have other orchids you'd like to add to the list of overrated orchids, again, feel free to do so in the comment section below. I think we're all gonna have a blast just reading the comments. So with that said, let's start with orchid number one. This will come as a shock for you. It is the Brassavola nodosa. Now, if you know me, you know that I absolutely adore Brassavolas. These are nighttime fragrant orchids, and even though they're not very flashy colored, they are simply so charming and so beautifully fragrant that I cannot resist them and I buy all sorts of hybrids. The nodosa, though, is arguably the most popular of the Brassavolas. And if we're strictly referring to collections, I don't really see why. Because there's a better one, and this is the Brassavola cucullata, which I don't have, but I have a hybrid. I used to have this orchid a lot of time ago. The Brassavola cucullata produces longer leaves. It is a pendant type of growth. It produces big, again, pendant type blooms that look very droopy, and the fragrance. I'm not exaggerating when I'm saying it is the most fragrant, most powerful thing I have ever smelled when it comes to plants in general. When I used to live in the apartment, I would be in the kitchen balcony and I could feel the fragrance of that Brassavola coming from my other balcony in the living room. It was that powerful. And overall, I just think it looks a lot better. Now, the Brassavola nodosa has a really, really great impact on our orchid collections, more than you know, because it has been used in hybridizing a lot. Even though the flower is white, the nodosa actually passes on a dotted pattern on orchid lips. So let's just think about the BC Saint Andre with that beautiful dotted tessellated lip, or the BC Maikai. That spotting comes from the nodosa. And there are actually other hybrids which have that beautiful patterning dotting on the lip that comes from the Brassavola nodosa. So from the point of view of hybridizing, the nodosa is actually really, really, really important. But speaking from the point of view of collections, just having the orchid in your private collection, I just feel like the nodosa is so overrated. Everybody who wants to start the journey of Brassavolas starts with the nodosa. I do have a very close hybrid of the nodosa, the little stars, and I have to say the fragrance is just not there. It smells nice, it's beautiful overall, but the flowers are tinier. And by the way, on my hybrid, the flowers are identical to the nodosa. And as far as I read, indeed, the nodosa has a bit of a different fragrance than the cucullata. So, smaller flowers, less powerful fragrance, non-pendant growth habit, well, all of these things are a minus for me. Therefore, I deem the nodosa overrated and the cucullata slightly underrated. The second orchid that I deem overrated, this will come as no surprise, the Psychopsis, whatever variety or strain you want to talk about. Now, the Psychopsis orchid actually has one of the most interesting flowers in the hobby. It looks like an alien, or a butterfly, or a robot, whatever your imagination tells you. The problem that I have with this orchid is that, one, it's in bloom pretty much all the time, and that can actually be a bad thing because you get way too used to it and you start losing your appreciation for the orchid. You stop working for your reward. Pretty much that's how I feel. But also the bloom display. Yes, we have the most beautiful and interesting flower in the hobby, but it is displayed on this long, slender, bare flower spike that keeps blooming over and over again. And not only is it awkward and hard to find a place for it, in a home at least, it's also unbalanced. The plant itself is not huge. It does have pretty broad leaves, but overall the plant, it's not very big. The flower spike shoots up 80 centimeters high, and then you have a almost 10 centimeter flower at the top. Nothing in between. Now, that display doesn't really appeal to me all that much. So the orchid taken separately, it's nice, it's beautiful, but overall, it's simply a little bit too overrated for me. Even though I had it and I found it beautiful, I just don't feel the need to have it once again. Although the Psychopsis is actually a very popular orchid in collections, many, many people have it and own it, I simply feel it's overrated for what it offers. And the bad thing is, for such an interesting and beautiful flower, you kind of enjoy it for 2-3 months and then you stop appreciating it. And that's the worst thing that can happen to an orchid. If it blooms too much, you just stop appreciating it. But maybe that's just me. I know that at least one of you guys expressed the same feelings about this orchid last time I talked about it, but let me know down below in the comments. Are you getting bored of your Psychopsis, even with this majestic flower it presents? Or am I the only weirdo? An orchid that I used to have a long, long time ago, maybe 5 years ago, is a Phalaenopsis equestris. When I purchased this orchid, I actually did it mostly because everybody was talking about it on the forum I was on at the time. Everybody wanted the equestris. It was a sort of a Billionaire Violacea of back then, of 5 years ago. And people were just so thrilled about it, and I never understood why. The equestris has a tiny little flower, even tinier than this Violacea that I'm showing you right now. The color is a bit washed, it doesn't have intense coloring. It can be purple, it can be whitish pink. Many of the times it doesn't really have a perfumey fragrance. Sometimes some people suggest it does smell a little bit like something, but most of the time it's not something you'd write home about. If we think about Brassavolas and even Violaceas or Bellinas, it's really not all that spectacular. The orchid looks like a complex hybrid. It produces these long flower spikes with these tiny little flowers, and the flower spikes are prone to producing a ton of keikis. And that's about it for the orchid. Other than that, there's just nothing all that interesting for me. Maybe because I'm not very keen on having keikis, so I'm missing out on that appeal of it. Maybe I'm not a fan of the color. It actually has that tone of purple that I just don't like in my orchid collection. I would much rather prefer having something like this. Look at this. This is a beautiful, intense color. So that washed out color coupled with the lack of fragrance, coupled with the appearance of the orchid, it looks like a complex hybrid, coupled with the very high flower spikes. I actually don't like high flower spikes or tall flower spikes, unless you have big flowers and cascading nature. Other than that, I just simply am not attracted to them. So overall, I could never understand the appeal of the equestris. And if you are into propagating Phalaenopsis and obtaining keikis, the equestris is definitely the way to go. She is really prone to producing keikis. But if you're not, I don't know, what am I missing out with this orchid? I cannot tell. Next up, an orchid that I am partially responsible to overhyping. It's such a weird feeling, actually. The Chysis bractensis. I have this orchid for so many years, and I always raved about, oh, I cannot wait for it to bloom. 2 years it didn't bloom for me. And oh, the pretty flowers, look at the pictures. And then it finally bloomed. And the flower lasted for a few days and they smelled a little like gardenias, but not as great. Nothing like gardenias, actually, when it comes to greatness. It just reminded me of them. It actually has a mushroomy or earthy type of fragrance to it. It's not repulsive, for me at least, but it's just not something I'm very, very fond of. And when I purchased this orchid, I was reading that it smells like caramel. And I was imagining, oh my goodness, a caramel-smelling orchid. Just the perfect companion for the Cherry Baby, which smells like chocolate, right? Wrong. To me, it smells nothing like vanilla or caramel or things of the sorts. It smells mushroomy. It has a little bit of a gardenia undertone to it, but of course, nothing like gardenias. And overall, the flowers last for a few days and you have to wait one entire year. And actually, take up a lot of space with this orchid. Just look at it. And afterwards, it's also losing its leaves. It is deciduous. So the old growth will look something like this. Not extremely appealing. So I feel that because I talked so much about it, waiting for it to bloom, I feel like a few people actually wanted to purchase this orchid and they were like, oh my god, Chysis, I want a Chysis. And I feel like I kind of overhyped it because I thought it would smell like caramel. And I thought the flowers will last 2 weeks at least, but nope. So at this point, I'm slightly disappointed in the Chysis and I feel like I overhyped it. I feel like it's overrated and partially because of me. So those of you who actually purchased this orchid, let me know down below, how do you feel about it? Are you disappointed in it? And if you're not, tell me why. Next up, we have a dendrobium. It is currently residing outside, and this is the dendrobium amethystoglossum. And I kind of have the same problem with this orchid as I do with the chaises. Now, I don't feel like I overhyped it or I made it popular in any way. I think it's already a very popular orchid in orchid collections. I'm starting not to understand why though. This orchid blooms once a year and the blooms again last very little, a little more than the chaises, maybe a week or so, but then they just start to fall. Partially, I understand the appeal of this orchid. It's because it's pendant and produces these beautiful pendant cluster blooms, but it does so only once a year. And also the clusters don't last all that long. And the orchid herself is tall, it's incredibly big. The longest cane on mine is about 80 centimeters. Now, of course, with this type of orchid, you'll have issues placing in your home, especially if you have a bigger orchid collection. I'm having issues with it in my grow space. I can imagine in a living room how awkward it would be to place it. And just for 2 weeks in the spring, enjoying the flowers and then having them fade and actually make a mess. Oh my goodness, the mess this orchid makes. The flowers are not even fragrant. I don't know, you guys. I mean, I like the orchid, of course. I just feel like it's overhyped. I purchased it because I did see a lot of people talking about it and loving it. And I just think it's a little overrated for what it puts out. It is absolutely gorgeous. It's just very ephemeric. It doesn't last long. And you have to put up with a lot to get that beautiful display for 2 weeks in the spring. Is it just me? Is it overrated? Am I wrong? What do you guys think? And the last orchid I'm gonna talk about today is the Dendrobium kingianum. I have this particular orchid actually for about 5 years already. It was a bigger clump, I saved a little bit of it, and there we have it. She's doing okay actually, but what's the appeal? I mean, I understand the appeal. It is a beautiful tiny little Dendrobium that smells a little bit like honey, a little bit like jasmine. I can see that, but the flowers are really tiny. And also this orchid is pretty finicky, if you're referring to the proper kingianum, which by the way, check the description down below. You can easily mistake this orchid for the Berriota. Chances are if you have a kingianum which blooms regularly without a winter rest and never gives you headaches, it's a Berriota. So check the description down below so you see what's the difference. The proper kingianum is actually a lot more finicky. And the blooms are very, very similar to the Berriota, actually. So, partially, yes, I do get the appeal of the kingianum, but people really try hard to make this orchid bloom. It's one of those dendrobiums that blooms once a year, and the flowers are not very, very long-lasting. It doesn't even produce a heck of a ton of blooms on one flower spike, if you're not skilled enough to produce that from this orchid, or if you don't live in Australia, where this orchid is native from. So, to me, the Berriota is a much, much better option for home growing and for those of us who cannot really provide perfect conditions for the kingianum. It looks very, very similar. It is a little bit bigger maybe in some cases, but it blooms and blooms and blooms. It doesn't even really require much of a rest in the winter time, and I think you're getting the benefits of the kingianum at a much, much lower cost, as it were. So for me, the kingianum is a little overrated. It's beautiful, it's lovely. I would actually always have it in my collection, but I would definitely have a Berriota next to it, because I'm pretty sure with the kingianum, I will always have issues reblooming it. I just like how it looks like. I do actually like the texture and the foliage and everything, and the fact that I do have a variety which is tiny and can clump out really beautifully. Other than that though, for the flowers, I'm not sure I want to keep this orchid for the flowers. I think that if you have a Berriota, you're all set. You don't need the kingianum. So these were my picks for the most overrated orchids that I currently know. Do you have any other orchids you feel are overrated? Just leave us a comment down below so we can all have a good laugh. So on that bombshell, I'm gonna end with an image of the Pileatum cross that I showed you yesterday. It opened more than yesterday. If I knew, I wouldn't have filmed it yesterday, but oh my goodness, look at this. Beautiful, I love this orchid. Oh my goodness, I was not expecting it to be so beautiful and nice and like, I love it, I just love it. And the flowers don't really look like they will be fading anytime soon. I love this more than the other Pileatum cross that I have. Not so much the coloring, but hey, who cares? It's a beautiful orchid and I'm gonna present it and talk a little bit more about it at the end of the month, but yeah, it opened up a lot today. So alrighty guys, thank you so much for watching this video. Hope you had a little bit of fun, and yeah, of course, you're always welcome to comment down below. And you know the drill, if you've enjoyed this video, give it a thumbs up. If you hated it, give it a thumbs down. Subscribe to my channel for regular orchid videos, tutorials, spotlights, and fun videos of the sorts. And if you like YouTube to notify you whenever I upload a new video, just turn on all notifications for my channel. And with that said, I'll see you all next time. Bye!